Welcome to this Killick Explains video, and welcome to part two of a three-part series on volatility. I don't need to tell you, this year, stock markets, 2020 that is, have been particularly volatile, and I think that that is now baked in for some time to come. Just remember, that's not a bad thing. As an investor, volatility is the price for the sort of long-term returns equities can deliver. But nonetheless, it's something that you need to get comfortable with. So, the background for this is what? Well, earlier this year, and if you've seen part one, you'll have seen these stats before, markets dropped by 30 to 35% across the world. A few weeks later, they recovered at pretty much the same pace, and rising volatility has kind of been baked into the market ever since. So what's going on? Well, again, the three forces, which appear in my first video and will appear at the start of the third as a reminder, are what? The action of central banks and accommodative monetary policy was part one, so say no more about that here. The rise of passive products, well, that's what we're talking about now in part two, and the behavior of investors. These are the three ingredients in part three. And for anyone wanting more detail, because I'm skimming in this video as usual, there's a paper at the bottom that I've referenced that's got the detail you want. Okay, so the rise of passive products. Now, don't get me wrong, I'm not saying this is a bad thing, but I'm saying it is a thing and it's had an impact on markets. So what do we got here? Vanguard estimate that passively indexed funds, and that's what we're talking about, things that track indices and sectors, so non-actively managed products, if you like, were around 10% of total assets in US equity funds back in 1993. Wind forward to 2016, that figure had risen to 45%, so crikey, 10% had become 45% by then, and that's had two intertwined effects. It's gone further than that since 2016, right when they took that snapshot. But so what? What does this mean? Well, these two effects are linked, but I've split them out just to make them easier to understand. Number one, overcrowding. So what do I mean by that? More active managers now use passive indices as benchmarks. All right, they've got, as these things have grown in popularity, active managers thought, I better keep half an eye on those, because if I can't justify performing somewhere near to, or ideally better than that, then I might be in trouble. So poorly performing funds, not wanting to be in the bottom quartile, which is where no fund manager wants to be, if you like. They're all sort of racing against each other. It's all about relative performance, not being bottom of the class. So poorly performing funds have tended to dump poorly performing assets, which are the ones that are cheap and best value, you might argue. And better performing fund managers have received funds to perform better performers, which are more expensive. So what you've had is the sort of poor performers, bottom quartile, getting out of the very assets that value investors are supposed to go after, are supposed to differentiate them as stock pickers. Money has moved across to nervous, better performing managers with expanding funds, thinking, better make sure I'm not caught out by the performance of an index. And that's going to tend to drag them towards the more expensive, less good value stocks in the market. Now, polarization is linked to that. So what do I mean by polarization? Well, basically, passive benchmark indices have diverged further and further from active mandates, partly as a result of just what I've just said. And when funds switch from active to passive, they tend to buy big names and sell smaller ones. So if you think about the construction of something like the S&P 500 index in the US, it's market capitalization weighted. So in other words, it emphasizes more heavily the really big tech stocks at the moment at the price of the really small ones. And if you buy that index, if you pursue that strategy, you're going to be buying the biggest, most well-known, most popular, and most expensive stocks in the market more than the smaller ones, the less popular, the less expensive. And some would say that means you are buying high, all right, and selling low, when you should be doing the reverse. And if enough people start following this sort of tailwind, you get polarization, you get a gap opening up, all right, and it exacerbates the gap between the mega and the small caps. And we've seen that concentration of money into a handful of names at the top of the big American indices, for example, to an extent that most investors don't remember in their sort of investing lifetimes. So overall then, when investors pile into convergence strategies, it tends to stabilize markets. What we've seen is everyone following divergent strategies buying the expensive stuff, piling into it, all right, dumping the stuff that's less popular. So you've seen divergent strategies being followed by a lot of people in the market at the same time. And the more this happens, the greater the scope for large corrections. The more you push that small basket of stocks up, the more you ignore the stuff down the bottom, all right, the greater the potential for some sort of snapback on a fairly regular basis. Now, the waning influence of active money is the flip side of the coin I've just introduced. So the rise of passive tends to mean you've got less room for active, if you like. So what effect is that having? And how would I evidence it, if you like? If a large stock in the S&P 500 drops, it will tend to pull down the whole index because it's market capitalization driven, as I just mentioned. But if individual securities in a basket are priced with reference to the S&P 500, they will then also be marked down, which will have an influence on the price of the stock I've just looked at. And you can get a kind of unvirtuous circle of downward momentum as a result. And that's a relatively recent effect that a lot of research is being focused on trying to work out at the moment. So evidence of the passive effect, if you like, on a particular corner of the market would be what? Well, it would be passive buying of dividend stocks. So some people are trying to work out what's going on in the market for stocks that traditionally pay some sort of dividend, pay a yield. So basically, the passive buying of dividend stocks can result in dividend payers being underbought at ex-dividend prices. Now, what I'm saying there is that everybody in the market knows that when companies pay a dividend, there's a point where they go what's called ex-dividend, and the market factors that in. But if a passive fund is buying the stock at the price it can see right in front of it, if you like, then you're going to get over time a subtle effect where passive money is directed at ex-dividend prices into low or no yielders in relative terms. Because essentially, if you're not paying a dividend, there is no ex-dividend drop, all right, doesn't happen. If you are paying a dividend, there will be. And if you think about it, passive funds are blind to that in one sense. They just hoover up on a market capitalization weighted basis the stocks they need to hold. And some people have said that subtle ex-dividend pricing gap has had a cumulative effect. All right, it may, I stress, help to explain the relative outperformance of low yield stocks, which is the opposite of what quite a few people would normally expect in the market. Now, there's more on that in the paper I mentioned, and I'll come back to in a moment, but there's some evidence of the march of passive funds and the way that the market is being slightly bent around those forces. So disappearing circuit breakers is the final technical point I want to make. You'd think surely active fund managers would step in to perceive any mispricing of the type that I've perhaps just suggested. Well, in an abnormal market, there might actually be insufficient liquidity and therefore willingness to do so. In other words, arbitrage opportunities are only corrected at a sensible level of risk, if you like. And meanwhile, funds linked to basket trades make no distinction and won't care about the difference between value and price. So if you've got an increasing army of passive investors who won't do anything about it, why would they? And you've got a smaller pool of active managers who perhaps don't have the incentives to do anything about it, these anomalies can persist. So, three parts. This was number two in the middle, all right? We'll come back to number three in the next video, the ingredients for increased volatility. For more about all the points I made in this one fairly quickly, there's a reference to a paper at the bottom. And if you prefer to just email me directly, then it's the usual place, editor@killick.com.